Good morning, everyone. On behalf of IntelliCap, I would like to welcome you all to today's WASH plenary. I'm Vineet Menon, and I lead the WASH practice at IntelliCap. As you all know, given the current health crisis, the challenges of providing safely managed water sanitation and hygiene services has emerged as a major area of focus for government and other stakeholders. To discuss the challenges and opportunities, we at Sankalp are curating a whole day track on water sanitation and hygiene. The objective of the sessions would be to pause and reflect on how the WASH system can be made more resilient and what role can various players such as the government, private sector, ecosystem enablers can play to accelerate achievement of SDG 6. The Government of India has been constantly addressing the WASH related challenges by launching several of its successful flagship programs like Swachh Bharat Mission, Namrut, Smart City Program, Jal Jeevan, which not only looks at last mile delivery, but is also looking at the sustainability of this whole programs. The recently launched Climate Smart Cities Assessment Framework also emphasizes on water and waste management. In order to know more about the government's plans and focus areas, we have with us Honorable Minister Shri Hardeep Singh Puri. Minister Puri is currently holding independent charges for Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs and Ministry of Civil Aviation, along with Ministry of Commerce and Industries. He has headed various Indian delegations to UN Security Council and has been an ambassador and permanent representative of India to UN and other international organizations. He has held several critical positions like Secretary, Economic Research and Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Joint Secretary, Ministry of External Affairs and Ministry of Defense, and many more positions at the Government of India. He has also been India's ambassador to Brazil and UK. It is an honor for us to have the minister join us for the plenary. Thank you, sir, for joining us. Along with him today, we have Ms. Naina Lal Kidwai, who would anchor today's discussion. Ms. Kidwai currently chairs the Indian Sanitation Coalition, which enables and supports safe and sustainable sanitation solutions by bringing multiple organizations on a common platform. In the past, she has also served as the president of FICCI. She has been repeatedly ranked in the Fortune Global List of top women in business in the Wall Street Journal and Financial Times. Ms. Kidwai has also received the Padma Shri from the Government of India for her contribution to trade and industry. Without wasting much of your time, I would request Ms. Kidwai to please take the discussion forward. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Vineet. And thank you, Minister Hardeep Singh Ji, for being with us with such alacrity as usual. You're a reformer, a thinker. You've always come forward on matters such as this. I will never forget how you agreed to launch my book on this very same subject, Survive or Sink, and how you are there for us whenever we need you on this subject of sanitation and safe cities. Now, exactly as Vineet said, given the current scenario, the COVID pandemic, and thank goodness that we as a country had achieved what we had in sanitation, in hygiene, in WASH, these same missions have become even more critical in this environment as we point our citizens to a safe, hygienic, and WASH type scenario. You, the government, have constantly been addressing these through several programs, the Swachh Bharat Mission, Amrut, others. So which of these initiatives do you think are going to be critical for us going forward? Are there any new initiatives you have in mind in the coming years, given the importance of what you have achieved and what indeed needs to continue?
Thank you very much, Naina ji. Thank you, Mr. Menon. It's always a pleasure to interact with persons as eminent as Naina ji. So I have absolutely no hesitation in joining in this interactive session. But she's asked a very focused question, and I can come to that in a minute on what new initiatives are on the horizon. But I want to make two comments. One is that the Sustainable Development Goals, or the 2030 Agenda, as it is popularly referred to, is slated for completion in the year 2030. Our urban population in 2030, by all accounts, is likely to be in the vicinity of 600 million. 600 million urban dwellers, which will roughly represent 40% of our total population. The second submission I want to make to you is, God forbid, if we had not, during the last 6 years of the Modi government, launched this very focused water, sanitation and hygiene, or WASH, as priority focused areas of government intervention, whether you talk about the Swachh Bharat scheme, urban, or Amrut, which covers 100 cities with a population of over 100,000 each, or, you know, the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana and a lot of the flagship programs. God forbid if we had not embarked on these and we had been confronted by this pandemic, COVID-19. Now, I was ambassador to the UN in Geneva. I was also ambassador in New York. We've dealt with viruses in the past, SARS, mortality rate of 17% as against 1.5% of this now. We've dealt with H1N1. We've dealt with Ebola. But this one is a sui generis case, one of a kind. And I think the only precedent, to the extent that we can have one, is the Spanish flu of 1918. And because most of us were not around in 1918, and most of us don't, in the normal course of event, look up the history of that period or read books on that, when millions of people were wiped off, we were not aware of it. And I just want to conclude that introductory few comments, man. Thank God we had the urban rejuvenation attempted through individual household toilets, community and toilets, that we had this massive program, and that the date of completion is another point I make, 2nd October 2019, when the Prime Minister spoke from the ramparts of the Red Fort. What did he say? He said that the most befitting tribute we can pay to the father of the nation on his 150th birth anniversary is to celebrate India as open defecation free. Mm-hmm. And 2nd October becomes important when the Mahatma was launching his political movement in India. You know, I keep telling my friends, and I don't mind repeating it. You see, my South African colleague of mine in New York once turned to me and said, you sent us an English educated barrister, University College London, and you know, called to the bar in a temple, and we sent you back a Mahatma. Now, the South African, you can start taking the credit, but what did he do when he came to India? He utilized some of that, but he raised it to another level. In 1916, in Varanasi, in speaking at the Banaras Hindu College, he made the categorical statement that sanitation is more important than even political freedom. That's the level at which the transformative change. And by 2nd October 2019, we had completed the ODF. It had become from a project of the people to a Janandolan, a people's movement. But we were not resting with that. We were going much further. So the work done in the Swachh Bharat Mission, Amrut, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, to build in those synergies further. Now, let me fast forward. I'm sorry I've taken a little longer than I'd intended to in the past. But Nanaji, the 15th Finance Commission has provided tied grants in the critical sectors of sanitation and drinking water in order to ensure additional funds to the local bodies over and above the funds allocated by the union and the state share under the centrally sponsored schemes, Swachh Bharat and Jal Jeevan Mission. Now, let me again go back for a minute. When I was inducted into this very, I mean, I think this is a basic transformational task. And I'm so happy that people like Nainaji are have lent their name and they're pushing this agenda. But you know, Amrut covers only 66% of our urban spaces. Yeah. So when my colleagues and friends, the urban ministers of big states like Shri Suresh Khanna in UP or elsewhere would call me and said, ki bhai iske aage kya karenge, 2019 tak to kar denge, Amrut is a, all these schemes, by the way, started in 2015. And they are 5 years completion schemes. So we completed Swachh Bharat Urban more or less in 2019, etc. But then that was only the first phase. Yeah. From there, we went to ODF plus, ODF plus plus. Then we brought in single use plastics and all those other issues. But let me come back to the 15th Finance Commission, and that's where we did. We didn't do an Amrut plus. What we did was a Jal Jeevan mission, a mission very ably served by my colleague and friend Gajen Singh Shekhawat and Bharat Lal, and earlier Param, who was a very dear friend who's now gone back sadly. To the World Bank. Sadly,
we get but it back. He promises he'll continue in this.
Exactly. Yeah. So I'm sure this is part of life. You know, good people go and then come back and they have their reason. Now, the 15th Finance Commission also recommended increasing share of urban local bodies in Finance Commission grants to local bodies to 32.5% in 2021. Which works out to rupees 29,250 crores across the ULBs, and gradually increasing it to 40% over the medium term from the previous 30%. So you are seeing two things. You're seeing basic objectives met in a fundamental transformational manner. And then you have the 15th Finance Commission coming in by enhancing the outlays, and 30% to 40%, frankly, is a jump and it's going well.
Yeah.
Now,
I was just going to say, thank goodness that this money coming in as it is in a tight manner has been agreed, because I panicked when, with the FISC being in the state it was, there was a cut back on budgets, and we saw a cut back on the SBM budget, but which was made up very quickly, allocation.
I think sanitation, Nanaji, is such a, and Swachhta, and if you look at all of it, is such a high priority that I wouldn't worry. You know, I have to, unlike others, I have to navigate my way through these, the challenges that are imposed by the financial situation. I mean, you had no growth in one quarter, you had other problems, etc. But I'm very happy to find that overall, there's no dilution in the political commitment. In fact, there's an increasing recognition that because we got these things right, we are able to manage confront the oncoming challenges in a better way. Now, the 15th Finance Commission has provided grants to million plus cities on agglomeration basis, 9,229 crores, with special emphasis on meeting the challenges of poor air quality, groundwater depletion, and sanitation.
Correct.
For the million plus cities, rupees 4,829 crores. Now, let me just see. For improving conservation, supply and management of water, and efficient solid waste management.
Right.
For non-million plus towns, a total of 20,021 crores, 50% of the funds are untied and the remaining 50% tied, with an equal share for drinking water and sanitation. Now, no matter which way you look at it, whether it is the mindset of the central government, the state governments, and I know we'll have an opportunity to talk about how you measure, empirically verify. I think this is all moving in the right direction, except that when you are dealing with the kind of backlog we had and the fact that you were able to achieve it, but the success or the implementation has to be empirically verifiable based on third-party verification. And I think the manner in which this has gone, I can tell you, after having been minister, I think now for three years and three months or so on this charge, I'm now very reassured to find, when I was a newly appointed minister, people said, aap toilet to bana lenge, par wo istamal nahi hungi. Then toilet to bana lenge, then like in a film where they will be used as tailor shops. Or toilet to bana lenge, they will not be fit to use. Look, change in India, given our democratic ethos, given our many fault line, change comes, but sometimes not at the pace at which we are wanting. But I can tell you on the Swachhta Andolan, the 5 years, 6 years of the Modi government have made a huge difference, huge difference. Therefore, what we have coming, I have absolutely no doubt that as we go along, the benefits of Swachhta in terms of hygiene and all those costs, I think the WHO, other people are doing. But also in terms of sheer value that they give in terms of to those who are living there, from something as materialistic as land values, you know, things are improved. So I think that consciousness is keeping in.
Absolutely.
How we take this further, that's where I think it's a government plus project, and civil society efforts like yours, Mr. Menon, and what Nayanaji is doing, etc. They have to all coalesce and re-energize it. I mean, we draw strength. I deal with so many NGOs in this sector. I must say, from Janagriya to Nayanaji, all. And I think that is what is making that crucial difference.
Yeah. And you know, you're so right. The best collaborations are those that see players across government, the civil society, citizens, and of course, the private sector. So let me just ask you on a pet theme of ours at the India Sanitation Coalition is on the FSTPs, where we have traditionally, of course, relied on very large sewage systems. And the desire now is to look at these smaller, much more quick to operate, cheaper systems, which fulfill our needs in terms of sewage treatment. And in order to do that, we would like the private sector to enter. And in order to enter, we need to make these projects financeable. We need the regulatory environment to be one which is friendly and really create the ecosystem which will allow and enable the private sector to operate in a for-profit mode. They are coming forward, but they're coming forward with some hesitation. What are the sort of things that you might do to encourage this participation in this much needed area, the area of delivery of public services in terms of sewage treatment, back working with our municipalities in our cities?
Look, there are two fundamental things that we should always consider. That for an economy of India's size, given the kind of activity that takes place, you know, economic and industrial activity on the one hand, and the amount of sewage that we produce, what was the idea that your target in October 2019 was that you would make India open defecation free? You nearly met that target because you didn't meet it. Now I would still say it's 99.99% because one particular state was not able to meet its targets in terms of all its urban local bodies. But on the STPs, we also wanted 100% solid scientific waste management. I mean, so I'm now making sure that I'm... There is no way we could have reached 100%, and we haven't reached 100%.
Yeah, it's a tough target.
My recollection is that before we started this program, it was 14%. Before we started. Before but before in 2000 and let's in 2014, 14, 15, even slightly higher. Yeah. Slightly higher. If you look at solid and So today, and Mr. Jindal, who was a project manager, he and I used to always say, I said, look, I am sticking my neck out and telling everybody that we are getting to this 100%. But this is a lot of this, bulk of it is private sector. We are doing something as a government. But you're absolutely right. We need the smaller plants, you need to make it economically viable for the private sector operator. And there, exactly. I think we've done a bit. Now, I can give you some of my, the official lineup on this. See, the Amrut Mission addresses the liquid waste management issues of large cities with population over 1 lakh.
Correct.
But you need to do it all over. So hopefully, Jal Shakti will take care of the remaining 33%. Now, given the very high cost of construction and maintenance of sewer networks, as well as the long time it takes to construct sewer networks, safe on-site sewage management becomes essential to cover entire population. Now, the states have been encouraging the ULBs to provide access to a range of technologically proven options for safe on-site sanitation management, including FSTPs, to the entire unsewered population. Now, I would not like at some stage, and Nainaji, and this is a thing that whatever is there in the current ecosystem in terms of incentivization, are there issues which you think need to be addressed? Are there gaps in that? I am always told by my colleagues that we are going from that 67% of, so abhi kitna hai, 67 hai aapka?
67.
67 hai. Aapka target timeline kitni hai 100% ke liye?
Sir, another 2 years, sir, by the
time. So now, agar 2 years, what is it that we can do? In fact, I would suggest as a direct outcome of our interaction today, can we within the next 6 weeks or so set aside a 2 or 3 hour session with the private sector, with the NGOs, to tell us what more needs to be done in terms of incentivization? Because I'll tell you what happens. Whenever we have a problem, the current situation, like when I had a huge dump in Amritsar, then we said, center says we are willing to take it over. But the contract was given already to a private sector party. The private sector party was not able to fulfill the contract. Now, all I'm saying is, let's try and identify issues without naming and shaming anyone. What more can we do from our side to provide a more conducive environment for these FSTPs to deliver on the ground, so that in 2 years, you see, the thing which I agonize about, and I'll be very candid with you, in 2 years, we will manage or reach the target as currently stipulated. But you know what kind of this thing? See, I look at what happened. Normal tendency, you see, in many places, we are doing the waste segregation very well, 100%. Wet waste, solid waste. But a lot of people take shortcuts, industrial restaurants, etc. will take it, break it, put it into the nearest garbage, and we've got stormwater drainage, all kinds of problems. So let's try and see what more is possibly doable. I think those 2 or 3 hours will be very well spent.
We welcome that.
Yeah, if you can, one of you can take the initiative. I invite the other think tanks. Not in terms of, I had this problem. In the ecosystem, is there something we can build in order to take this forward?
I think this is a really very welcome, and I know that it will get serious consideration from you. So we will absolutely take you up on this offer of coming together and offering you some of these thoughts from people who are working in the space. And I just wanted to ask you in terms of interesting tools in this very tech-oriented era and very tech-oriented government. You've got this garbage-free city rating tool, which I hope you are seeing the kind of uptake you would like from the ULBs. Is there such a framework also being looked at for liquid waste management? Because as we've gone to ODF and now moving to ODF++, we want to see that same sewage treatment also getting the attention of technology, and to see society and citizens and ULBs being rated on these fronts. Are these sort of technology and tools things that you might look at going forward?
The answer to your question is simple. We have to look at it going forward. there's no option on that. You know, so far the tools which we are looking at, where does a city stand on sanitation coverage, overall liquid waste management, the ODF protocols, ODF, ODF plus, 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 plus water plus. They were introduced in 2016. Again, what we need to do is, see, the Swachh Bharat original scheme was designed on ODF and solid waste management.
Right.
ODF plus and water plus were added to it. And now I think we are at the stage, stage where you need to sit down with all your stakeholders, work out a compendium of technologies and what needs to be done. A lot of good work is being done at the local level. I mean, people treat, you know, that you take the sewage water, you're able to treat it, utilize it for certain purposes, reuse it, etc., etc. But, you know, we've got to do this really on a war footing. War footing meaning ki unless you are able to set very strong timelines. But again, this is something again we can look at in another interactive session.
So we look forward to also nurturing some of the startups that have offered some of these tools and technologies to help us work in these deliveries. But it's great to hear, as I expected we would from you, that there's a very open mind to this. Do we have any more time, Vinny?
Let's take one more overall direction. Where are we going? I mean, this is what I would like to understand. I'm happy to answer any question. I think we have gone personally, and I want to test a response from you. We have gone from an approach which is naming and shaming, put elegantly in the Swachhta Sarvekshan. You know, the Swachhta Sarvekshan started very modestly. It started with what, 76 cities initially?
Yes.
76 cities. Now it has all 4,000, 5,000 jitne bhi cities hain hamare yahan, all the ULBs. Earlier it was that if a city didn't do well, you know, this didn't happen, that happened. I think the next phase, you will have to go into something a little more severe. That is, if you are not doing this, which can take one of many forms. It can those who are responsible. You know, when I first went to one of the cities which is constantly ranked very high, I think it was Bhopal or Indore, I think.
Indore.
And I asked somebody there, I said, what does it take to produce Swachhta of this kind? And the answer was a good chief minister, a good mayor, a good something, which is standard. But I think we were missing one thing. You can have a good chief minister and you can also have a good mayor. But if it has not got into that public consciousness, into the thing, you know, in those cities which are clean, when the Swachhta van comes out with a jingle or music, there's a public resonance.
People come out.
That we now will need to build that thing in, so that you will then literally shame people out of it. Because I travel around and I can tell you, I'm very proud of the fact that, you know, some cities are doing well, but I sometimes go there and I react immediately. I say, well, somebody here somewhere is not doing it. Now, we need to be a little more strict on that. And I think it's coming from the people. It's a project that the Prime Minister had. It is now a people's project, and that people's project needs to...
I think you're so right that without citizens and community engagement, these projects cannot sustain. But we have seen a very important link in there, and that is the municipal commissioner. And the quality of municipal commissioner makes and breaks the program at the city level. And it's wonderful to see that we are being able to showcase more and more of them as being wonderful examples to replicate. So anything that we can do to help them learn from each other and pull them together through programs and sharing of information would be invaluable. I would just also say that as we look at the private sector engagement, Minister Sir, it's going to be so important to ensure that exactly that engagement of government and municipality with the private sector is one which will enable funds to flow in time and to encourage the private sector to engage. And that is still at very initial stages. So we have to work very hard to make sure that the trust builds on both ends and that both fulfill the requirements, that the private sector absolutely fulfills the requirements and that on the other side, the payments also happen on time. Because these are today seen as some of the obstacles which we need to tackle as we go forward. But I must end this by asking you how you would like us to work going forward and the direction that you would set for those of us who work in the field.
Well, Nanaji, first of all, it's absolutely essential that this kind of an interactive session, this kind of dialogue should continue. But can I make two comments here? You mentioned the interface with the municipal commissioner and good municipal commissioner. I want to share a secret with you. For those of us who are having to deal with this issue from the government end, we very quickly are able to identify a good municipal commissioner. Yes. And I can tell very, very soon into my induction into this ministry, we found one of the municipal commissioners truly outstanding, and we immediately got him to join us as joint secretary dealing with one of our flagship missions. Now, that clearly, and I can see that kind of thing. But the second issue, which is even more important, where we are doing things, the management of urban local bodies.
Yeah.
You see, I am not willing to believe, you see, many of our urban local bodies are much bigger than cities in other countries. You know, they are huge in terms of canvas coverage, resources, and if they're not raising resources, they are themselves to blame or something is to blame. We need to deal with it. Now, one of the schemes we introduced recently was very interesting. What is the name of that scheme where fresh graduates, about 100, what is the name of the scheme?
TULIP.
TULIP is a very interesting scheme. Where, how many people are we taking in? 500 something. Very, very big number. So, you know what happens, that we have fresh engineers who graduate after a first degree. Now they need experience, and our urban local bodies need, you know, people who have educated, etc. So we've done this scheme, and I even during the COVID period, I introduced this scheme with, I think, one of the other ministers, with the HRD minister, with Nishangji. So I will then I'll get you the details of this. And I checked the other day, scheme is working with several other schemes like this.
Yeah, it's a great idea.
We need to ensure that our governance focus in terms of the urban space results in urban local bodies being empowered. Yeah. Now, that is what the Finance Commission, that is what our efforts are there, and that is where we also need. Now, I am not willing to believe. Now, that's what the advantage of having those engineers there. You know, urban local bodies today, the smart cities, they're dealing with technology, they're dealing with smart traffic management, they're dealing with all. To equip them, to empower them, etc., you need to bring youngsters in, foster a sense of participation, and get those outcomes. I don't see how you can do it without civil society, the private sector, and all the others available.
Yeah. So, Minister, thank you so much for this interaction. I think you leave everyone who works in this space with encouragement to come forward in the spirit of partnership. And a big congratulations to you for what you've achieved. And we are looking to see you achieve tenfold more to help us as a nation get to the targets that we have set ourselves and will continue to build on. So thank you. Thank you ever so much.
Nanaji, yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Always good to meet you.
And one of my younger colleagues assured me that my figure was way understated. The number of interns that are coming in are 25,000.
That's an army.
That urban local bodies will get, you know, everyone will have a few dozen support. Or so. And then once it goes, you see, the idea is to bring these youngsters in, familiarize them. They might get absorbed in some of the industries, etc.
Absolutely.
And this will serve as practical training. Or they may be able to, you know, also, these are many of our urban missions require professional people to be involved. And I think if we can marry the civil society and the private sector component onto this, because these are the people who will ultimately form the backbone of what we are doing in the urban space.
Yes, they are citizens of tomorrow. So absolutely. Yes. It's wonderful. We will pick up on that. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. And just on a closing remark, as you said, IntelliCap will take the lead in having that hearing with you, and we will also convene the key private sector players as well as players like ISC and NANA and others who are in the sector, so that maybe in a month and a half time we will get back to you with a proper plan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am.
Bye. Bye, Hardeep ji. Bye.